Okay, so today we're going to take the things we worked on yesterday, we're going to put it all together to solve some equations. Yesterday we were setting up problems, and today we'll be solving. So I got three problems up here for factoring. Those are supposed to be the quickest types of factoring.
Because the a value and the c value both square root. So this should be quick factoring using square root. So I don't have to think a whole lot. I can go straight to parentheses because we can square root. See, here is 25. The square root of 25 is 5. So I'm putting 5 in my factors. We got a negative 10 in the middle, so we'll use minus signs. And that's factored. Square rooting. And we can write it as 1 binomial squared. Same thing. Okay, number 2. I can't see it right there.
Okay, I know the square root of 16 is 4, and I know the square root of 49 is 7. So I got my 2 parentheses.
Instead of just x squared, it's 16x squared. So instead of just x, I put in 4x.
And then the c value is square root of 7. So I got 4 and 7 in my factors.
And this is subtraction.
So they'll both be subtracting. And so I can write that as 4x minus 7 squared. Now, I kind of want to check for that 56. Like, what about the 56? A lot of times we want to ask. So, if the negative 56 in the middle, how do I see that? What is that in the problem? Can anybody find 56 in these factors? In there. Yeah, so it's definitely there. Yeah, so 4 times 7. Is negative 28, right? And then negative 28 doubles. So that negative 56 is in the problem. You don't see it, but if you just multiply them together and double it, you'll see the middle number. You could also FOIL. When you FOIL this, you'll see the negative 56 here. And number 3, there's a 4, so I'll square that to make it 2. There's an 81. So my parentheses would be 2x plus 9. And since it's the same, I can read it as a binomial squared. What about the 36? Well, 2. We've got a question on that work. All right, we'll check the odds from yesterday. Hopefully you checked them.
Hopefully you use the back of your book and you check the odds. I like that. Checking and then coming in and saying, man, I checked
17. I couldn't get it right. And then you know exactly which one you have a question about.
See on the bill, the answers. Anybody not here? Look on there, get the answers. How will they understand it? I don't know, but at least you know what you missed. Showed some of these yesterday in class. Here's your answers to 1, 3, and 5. So I did want to talk about 5 for a moment. Pretty much from here on out, if you're presented with a negative and you have to square root, you've got to put the I in. So I didn't cover any examples with imaginary numbers. If there is square rooting, there's a chance you're going to have an I value. So because we have a negative 100, we square root, hopefully you don't just have 10, make that a 10i because it's negative. Okay, let me scroll to some more answers. Alright, here is 15 and 17, but we're getting into these fractions. More complicated, but if you leave it in fraction form and you just pick up on the pattern, it's a little bit easier than decimals, honestly. When the middle number is odd, every single time the middle number is odd, you got it. You put your number over 2. It doesn't divide nicely, so you just square it. So you square the top, 13 squared is 169, square the bottom, 2 squared is 4, and you just got to work with an ugly fraction. So when I put it in parentheses, I go back to square rooting. The square root of 169 is 13, square root of 4 is 2.
You have a question?
Yeah. They get the plus 25.
The there's a formula to create a C value. And it's not just any C value. The best C value is the middle number divided by 2 squared. So whatever's in the middle, you put it over 2 and you square it, and that'll give you the best possible C value. Any more questions on that? Okay, the diagram on the next page is a little bit weird. I don't really love these things, but some people do. You bring the 2x and 2x together, makes a 4x, and 4 is your perfect number. And I'm going to go over 21 after I tell you the steps for that one. Mm-hmm. All right, so we're going to move forward with actually solving today. Here's the steps for solving. So yesterday was setting you up to have the skills to do the actual solving. Here's the steps we'll go through today. I'll do 3 with you, and then you'll practice more on your own. And then some people like this even better than factoring. So here we go. Steps to solving by completing the square. I'm going to write them over here so I can use my screen later. So you know, this is usually for problems that can't factor. If something could factor, you normally just go through the factoring process, but every now and then you get a quadratic that doesn't factor, so you'll use these steps. If something doesn't factor, it's usually because the C value is problematic. So the first thing you want to do is you want to move the C to the other side. So you take it and you put it on the other side, and then you're going to make a better C. Create a new C using B over 2 squared. The trick about step 2 is when you create the new C, you have to write it on both sides of the equal sign. So you're following the rules of algebra. And then after that, you will be able to factor and then solve it squared. So when you're done writing those steps, we're going to go to page 220. I'm not going to move the screen. No. Question. So we're doing 228 through 10 to follow along with these steps. When I see you guys on that gray box page on there, you're ready. Okay. got 8 through 10? You want me to, Are we ready?
Know it.
So is there anything that multiplies to 8 and adds to negative 4? Like 2 times 4 is 8, but then that makes either 6 or 2 or... No, right now it doesn't factor. Can't solve it. It's problematic. So we're going to move C. I should have written that just like that. We're going to move C. So we're going to subtract that C out of there and make a new question. I leave a big blank space for a new C. We're going to leave a big blank space for a better C value. The best possible C value is what we spent our time on yesterday. So we'll do negative 4 over 2 squared, and we're going to write that where the 8 used to be. So I divide first. Negative 2 squared is 4. So my new number is 4. The problem will work best with a 4 in it. Now, you can't just put numbers in wherever you feel like it. That's not how algebra works. If I'm going to put a 4 here, I have to put it on the other side as well. And that means I have the equation still balanced. So if I want this better C here, I had also need to put it here. Okay, so my problem is now x squared minus 4x plus 4 equals negative 4. I went ahead and I combined like terms. So I'm on step 3, factor, and then solve it. So this is set up now to factor quickly. The square root of 4 is 2. The middle number is negative. And it's a binomial square, so you can write it the short way. So now we have factored, and now we solve. By square rooting. So I have to square root a negative 4, so I'll have to write that as 2i. I'll have to remember the plus or minus sign. All the previous lessons of this chapter are really important for this problem. My final answer is 2 plus or minus 2i. So this actually makes a lot of sense. I couldn't factor it the old way because my answers are imaginary. There's no x-intercepts on this parabola. There's imaginary solutions. That's why we can just use the old factoring method. We had to go through this whole long process. So this is usually done in problems that cannot be factored. Alright, I'm gonna pause and let you guys try 9 and ask questions. Same steps. What are you going to do here at number 9?
You're going to add the B to both sides. And then put it in the B.
What's the B over 2 square going to be?
A over 2 square, that's going to be 16.
Don't worry about that. Square it. Right here. If you gotta write a radical bar over a negative number, you take the I. Yeah, so Doing it right now, we need the leading coefficient to be 1. It has to be a simple, more of a simple one. Plus or minus I radical. Then what would you do here on 10? Yeah, because we can't work with that number in front. So you'll have to divide it out. And sometimes when you divide it out, it creates a whole storm of issues with fractions and things. But this one's nice because they all do divide by 3. So in order to get that leading coefficient to be 1, we're going to divide everything by negative 3. You can take that GCF and divide it out. So I'm doing both sides by negative 3. So now I start the process. Now you begin the steps. Wait a minute.
Did I get 10 right? Did I go 2 times? 2 times. We'll cover it up.